chapter 1. We're going to start 6 through 10, and we're going to talk about the gift. We know Jesus came and became the gift for our salvation. Now we're going to talk about Jesus went away so that we have another gift to come. And we're going to talk about that gift this morning. We're just going to do it from a different scripture than you probably heard it taught this way. This is Paul talking to Timothy. I'm going to read it out of the New King James first, and then we'll go, when we break down the verses, to the NLT and part of it. 2:6-10. Excuse me, 1:6-10. I lost my place. Therefore I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a power of love and of a sound mind. Therefore do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner. But share with me in the sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God, who saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began, but now has been revealed by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Father, we thank you for your word. I'd ask you to bless it. Holy Spirit, let my lips and my voice be able to communicate what you want to communicate to your people today. And Lord, let it grow and let it become seed. Let the seed become fruit and sowed on good ground in the name of Jesus. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. We know Jesus has already come the first time to establish salvation, to give you the right to become a child of God and to join into God's family. He's already come the first time, and he's getting ready to come a second time.
Hallelujah.
And that's not the rapture, because he doesn't physically touch the earth in the rapture. This is after the tribulation period. He comes to set up his throne in Jerusalem and set up his kingdom for 1,000 years, by which we will be coming back, and I'll get to ride my white horse, and we'll get to come back on horses, see the Mount of Olives split, and rule and reign with him 1,000 years. That's not far off. The rapture will come before that. But he came to bring salvation as a gift. Okay? Now Paul here is talking about a different gift. He's talking about something being stirred up in you that was given you after salvation. Okay? If you read Timothy, you find out his mother and grandmother were Christians. Because he said, I see that the same faith is in you that was in them. He was brought up a Christian. Now he's a minister of the gospel. How many people ever get down and get discouraged?
Yes.
How many people just get wore out?
Yes.
With life?
Right.
In Daniel, he said that it's the devil's job, the enemy's job, to wear the saints out. He wants to wear you out and get you discouraged. And with all the stuff going around in pagan society, Timothy was starting to get worn out. So Paul told him something simple. Stir up the gift of God. Now I've always wondered, what gift is he talking about? You've got the 9 gifts of the Spirit. You've got different gifts in the church. You've got the gifts to the church. What gift is he talking about? Because he never mentions a specific gifting, but he says the gift. The gift is singular. You know what he's talking about? The gift of the Holy Ghost. Because the Bible says that through the Spirit, all the other gifts are manifested as He wants to through whoever He will let Him. You have certain gifts, if you've been baptized in the Holy Ghost, that you will be able to operate in as He wills. If you're here to help, if you're a gift to help people, if you're a gift of an usher, if you're a gift of a teacher, whatever your gifting is, it comes through the Holy Ghost. So Paul's telling Timothy, stir up the gift that's in you, which is the Holy Ghost. Have you ever been taught that you should have a relationship with the Holy Spirit just like you have a relationship with Jesus? He is not an it. He is a person. Just like Jesus is not an it. Just like Father God is not an it. Neither is the Holy Spirit an it. It is a He. And He is a person. And He lives inside of you. Did you know the Bible says that you can't even get saved unless the Holy Ghost draws you? Which means God has extended Himself to you to draw you. Otherwise, you would be lost and going to hell with no hope. To stir up in the Greek means to kindle a fire. You ever been around a campfire and it starts going out and you start poking it and stirring the embers and the fire comes back up? A lot of times we as Christians have the same problem. We let life get involved with us and we let circumstances affect us to the point that sometimes our fire ain't where it should be. It'll kind of drop down a little bit to some embers. And what he's telling Timothy here, I know you're busy and I know everything that you got to deal with, but I want you to stir up that fire that's in you. Stir up that gift that's in you and reignite that fire to set ablaze all of those you come in contact with. You're supposed to be fire to those around you. The Bible says even he makes his ministers a flame of fire. There should be a fire in your belly as a Christian. There should be a desire and a hunger that's so supernatural you can't contain it or control it. You should want everybody to know the Jesus you know. You should want everybody to be touched the way you've been touched. You should want everybody that's sick to be healed. You should want everybody that's bound to be delivered. But most importantly, you should burn with a desire to please the one who gave you the gift of eternal life. And now you're not just a slave, you're not just a servant, now you are a son or a daughter in the kingdom of God, which means you're royalty.
Yes, hallelujah.
I'm tired of Christians walking with their head down like they're subpar people. You're royalty. You're not heirs to Christ, you're heirs with Christ.
That's right.
Woo! He's your older brother. That means you're going to rule and reign with him.
That's right. Thank you.
That means you're going to be right there with him. You get to sit in his throne and his power with him.
Hallelujah.
Now you're an heir. You know what the Bible says about heirs? There's legions of angels that are waiting to work on behalf of those that are the heirs of salvation. That's you. How many of your angels are unemployed? As a believer, you have the ability to charge angels to go do your bidding in the kingdom of God. They're waiting on you. How many of them don't have a job? The Bible says you shall charge angels. What does that mean? You will instruct them. You will give them an assignment. Because they're to work on your behalf to fulfill your destiny in the kingdom of God, to change the world we live in, to change the world around each and every one of you. You see, you never walk into a place alone if you're born again. You never walk into a place without the answer if you're born again. Why? Because not only do you have God inside of you, you have angels around you walking with you. Have you ever seen the president when he goes and walks? He's got a couple of Secret Service agents right on his hips. And then he's got three or four people behind him. And sometimes he'll even have military people all around him. That's how you can picture yourself in the kingdom of God. You're walking as a representative, an ambassador of God Almighty. And now you have a Secret Service in the military and all around you. They are the angels of God. You can't see them, but they're there. They're here in this building with you today. And all they want to do is to serve the King by doing what you need Him to do to fulfill your purpose. They're there for you. I ain't never seen an angel straight up. I thought I got a glimpse of the backside of one time, but I ain't sure because I was heavily medicated. And no, I wasn't part of it. I just had knee surgery, and I remember looking up for a brief second, and I seen something bright white just step outside the curtain, and I remember just enough that I said to the nurse, "Where did the angel go?" And then I woke up in my room. But I noticed it was different than just a doctor coat because this one radiated light. Now, I don't know if that's just the medication or I seen the backside of an angel after he knew I was all right. I don't know. I like to say, but I did ask the nurse, "Where'd the angel go?" So they're with you all the time. You're never alone. When you walk in a store, you're never alone. If you walk into a job interview, guess what? I got all heaven backing me. Yeah. Throw your head up, throw your shoulders back, and in a confident way, not an arrogant way, a confident way, you just say, "That's all right. Glad to meet you," because there's nobody higher than who you know. No athlete higher than who you know. No president higher than who you know. Because you know the King that created it all. You have a personal access to God Almighty Himself. You may not have access to the president. You may not have access to your favorite athlete. But you have access to God who created it all. You can't get no greater than that.
That's right.
So kindle a fire. In Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit is represented by what? Tongues of fire. Tongues represent languages. Fire meat has two purposes. It's either meant to destroy or purify. If you're born again, it will destroy the junk in your life and help purify you for the service of the kingdom of Almighty God. John the Baptist said in Matthew 3 and 11, "He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire." Luke 3:16. Excuse me. John said, "Indeed, I baptize you in water, but there's one coming after me. He's going to baptize you in the Holy Ghost and with fire."
Yes.
Now, Paul talks to Timothy talking about stirring up the gift. Stirring up the Spirit of God in you. Rekindling the fire. Hey, when you first got saved, I'm going to tell you, when I first got saved, nobody had to try to trick me to come to church. I didn't have to have nobody ask me, "You want to go to church this morning?" I didn't have to have somebody say, "We're going to have cookies and ice cream if you'll come to church today." I didn't have to have nobody tell me, "We're going to go bowling after church if you'll just come to church." I didn't care where it was, when it was, and how it was. I just wanted to be in the presence of God and worship Him because of who He is, not because of whatever was being created to try to attract me. Because I had already been attracted by the Most High God. What more can you do to get me in here? In today's society, we've got a lot of apologetic people that come to church, but we have very few people that know how to repent.
That's
There's a difference.
Yes, there is.
Repentance will bring change in your life. Conversion will bring change in your life. An apology will change your temporary circumstance. Because once the guilty feeling wears off, you go back to doing what you were doing before. When you truly have the Holy Ghost get a hold of you, when you truly change your heart and allow God to work on you, you won't have to worry about the circumstances because you'll be so on fire for Him that you won't have to try to think. You'll just automatically want to do the right thing. You'll want to go to church because you love being around God's people. You'll want to read your Bible because that's food to you. That's your source of life. Most Christians read their Bible less than 5 minutes a week. Most preachers pray less than 5 minutes a week. So that ought to tell you the state of the church. Give us this day our daily bread. What's the daily bread?